and welcome to the Retro Hour podcast, episode number 98, your weekly dose of retro gaming and technology news with me, Dan Wood.
And me, Ravi Abbott.
On the big 98. You know, it's actually quite appropriate because I've been messing around with Windows 98 this week.
Oh, cool. Yeah, what you've been doing. That's a bit old school. If you just installed it on your new machine.
No, I've actually got an old Pentium 4 lying around, and I thought, you know, for some reason, you know, Windows 98 was the first version of Windows I had at home. Wasn't really all that nostalgic for it recently, but I was watching. Do you ever watch a YouTuber called Drugger One?
Yeah, I've seen a few. You recommended him, actually.
Yeah, his videos are like everything that could possibly go wrong with hardware goes wrong for him. And he's doing like a Windows 98 install video recently, and I thought, you know, I remember stuff like Encarta and Netscape Composer and all those.
You need to make sure you've got second edition as well, because that was always the improved 98 from what I remember.
I've got second edition with Plus Pack.
Oh, wow. All the stuff. I remember the Plus Pack.
I've been playing around with Encarta. I've been back at school. It's crazy.
It's crazy. Well, we were talking the other day about mobile phones and how they were kind of taking up your life, and you installed an app on one, and then I can tell you about my 3210 experience that I had.
Now, this was just because, you know, if you didn't hear that episode of the podcast, we appreciate not everyone listens to every show. That's fine. We don't get offended. But I was away for a few weeks. Kind of did without my phone, had a bit of a digital detox, and actually realised that I coped quite well with it, you know. And you were talking about this, the fact that you downloaded this app that shows you exactly how long you spend using your phone.
Yeah, it's called Moment, yeah.
So that scared you a bit when you saw your result, didn't it?
Yeah.
What was your result? Do you remember?
I think it was like 5 hours or 6 hours of solid use a day.
5 or 6 hours a day. So your idea was to get rid of your smartphone.
And start living in the now.
Well, I'm looking here. So this has been tracking me now for about 2 weeks. It's not actually as bad as I would have thought. I think my highest on here was about 4.5 hours.
Oh, you're better than me, Dan. God,
you looked at some of them about 2 hours a day.
Yeah, that's pretty good. So you're pretty restrained, actually.
42 minutes today, my phone.
Oh, wow.
Not too bad. So that's kind of made me feel a bit more at ease. But you tried to get rid of your iPhone and you went old school and tried using a Nokia 3310. But how long did this last in this experiment?
Yeah, it lasted about 2 days. And yeah, the thing about it was, I thought, oh, you're going to live in the moment. Everything's going to be great. But actually, everyone else has got a phone. So you're sitting there in a restaurant and everyone's looking at their phone and then kind of looking up and talking to each other, then going back to their phone. And it's like, you're just an outcast, a social pariah, just sitting there with no kind of way of getting into the wider world. I was on the coach. There was no MP3 player. I was stuck playing Snake. I had something interesting happened in the city. I wanted to take a photo of it. I had no way of taking a photo. Yeah, so I decided I can't fight this. I've kind of got to join the guys and just have a bit more restraint.
If you can't beat them, join them, yeah, as you're saying. So it is true, and in a way it is a bit tragic, but, you know, it's looking at my usage on my iPhone, wasn't quite as bad as I thought it was going to be fair. Still 4.5 hours in one day. It's still quite a lot to use a device, but I couldn't live without my iPhone. Like, but, you know, it was nice to have a holiday from it, but I do rely on it for a lot of things.
Totally. And yeah, I now see them for the usefulness and kind of realise there's not a utopian world where everyone's not using phones and chatting and communicating. There's everyone's engrossed and that's it, yeah.
It was an interesting experiment to do, though, I think.
Oh, yeah. So, no, it's good.
Yeah, if anyone else has done that, maybe you've gone off-grid. Or maybe, because my dad, actually, he got an iPhone about maybe 3 years ago, but he still used, you know, the smaller Nokia, was it the 8250 or something? He used that until about 2013, 14.
Well, my housemate was telling me his brother's actually got a phone, and every time he rings up, his brother goes, I'm running out of power, quick, and it just cuts. So maybe that's the solution, just have one that doesn't work.
Essentially have it plugged in like a landline then, doesn't it? So yeah, worth trying though, Ravi. You know, I applaud you for trying.
Oh, thank you.
Brave experiment.
Two days, that was it.
Now, obviously, this show is getting towards its second birthday very soon. You know, episode 100 coming up in a couple of weeks, and we're already planning our big Christmas quiz. Now, we're going to be doing this again at Christmas time. If you didn't hear last year's, so much fun. Essentially, I'm the Quizmaster. We get you and Joe in. Paul Drury from Retro Gamer magazine. Oliver Wilmot from the NVA comes in as well. And you have to take back the crown this year. You got thrashed last year.
No, it wasn't that bad. But yeah. We had a game and then we lost it. So this time we will try and maybe slip down a couple of quid to get the questions in our favour.
Yeah, just top this coffee up with something a little bit stronger. Yeah. But, you know, after that, we're already making plans for what's going to be happening in 2018, which just sounds nuts how quickly this year's gone by.
It does, but we've got fantastic events coming up, like Play Blackpool, which is a really traditional kind of old school arcadey style event. And in a seaside town, what more can you get?
Now, obviously, Play Expo is the biggest retro gaming event in the UK. You know, we go to it twice a year with the official podcast of Play. You may have realised from the you know, the talk stage that we've done 2 years
ago.
Yeah,
the Retro Hour stage. That's
And we're going to be bringing that back for the third time. This is going to be at Play Expo in Blackpool. Now, like you mentioned, normally it's in the summer. This year, though, we're moving it a little bit earlier. It's going to be on in February, the 10th and the 11th. There's a few reasons for that. Now, first of all, if you want to stay at the hotel, they're doing some really good prices. Obviously, it's out of season in Blackpool.
Yeah, that's it. You know, out of season, everything's going to be cheaper.
And I think, I mean, yeah, I've been talking to a lot of people. Obviously, Andy, who is behind the Play Expos, he's from Blackpool. And he's like, you know, there's loads to do. So some people have been saying, oh, it's out of season, everything will be shut. And he's like, it is just a normal town still, you know. All the bars and restaurants and all that are still going to be open.
Well, we were thinking of doing a little thing in the evening, weren't we, as well? Maybe a video game quiz or a retro hour piss-up or something like that.
Whenever we're in town, there's a piss-up. But, I mean, we are very pleased to announce that we are going to be involved in Play again. And it's going to be happening on the weekend of February the 10th and the 11th, back in Blackpool again. I mean, Manchester is an amazing event, you know. It's a massive venue. You walk in there, it's like an aircraft hangar. Everything's glamorous and everything. It's a great event. Blackpool, though, is just loads of fun, isn't it?
Oh, Blackpool, yeah. That's the best way to describe it. Loads of fun. If you want to go back in time, go to Blackpool. That is the 90s.
Drinks prices are still in the 90s. It's amazing.
It's fantastic.
And we're going to be doing the Retro Hour stage again, hosting the talks on the weekend. And we can announce our first panel is going to be, well, you know, some previous guests who've been on the Retro Hour podcast, because we love YouTubers.
Oh, totally. Doesn't everybody? Like, you know, I just come home every day, look at my subscriptions and just go, oh, new video from this guy, new LGR, new... Oh, it's amazing.
Because, you know, we do a podcast. We both started on YouTube. You know, we've been doing YouTube for longer. And it's kind of where... I'd say, you know, back in the day, magazines were what held the gaming scene together. For retro gaming now, I think YouTube is really where it's at, as well as podcasting.
Especially the British YouTubers. They seem to have their own little crew and kind of, they don't get that much light and they're not kind of talked about as much as other people.
Yeah, not like your AVGNs and all that kind of thing. But we're going to be bringing some of our favourite YouTubers. We've handpicked a few of our favourite guests that we've had on the show and that YouTubers that we know everyone who's involved in the UK and European retro scene loves. So Guru Larry... Larry Bundy, behind the Fact Hunt series.
Hello!
he's going to be joining us. Kim Justice, of course, our good friend Kim. Had her on the show before. We were hanging out with her at Play Expo, actually, in Manchester, weren't we, a few months ago?
Yep.
Slopes Game Room. Now, Slopes, I think he's only been doing YouTube for about a year, but he's already just got over 50,000 subs. So he's doing very well. His videos are really interesting, too. And Nostalgia Nerd.
Ah, yes. I'm just a fan of every single one of these channels, so it's going to be just exciting for us to have all these people on stage. And I just think coming and being able to meet them, probably come out and have a drink with us as well, it would be great.
Well, we're going to be there, you know, stopping over. We've all got hotels, going to be there for the weekend. So if you want to come along, if you watch Guru Larry, Kim Justice, Slopes Game Room, Nostalgia Nerd, there might be more to be announced soon as well. We're working on a few others. But I think, you know, you don't really get YouTuber panels at retro shows in the UK.
No, you don't. No, I think this is the first. So. Yeah. Let's see how it goes.
Oh, it's going to be really interesting, I think. So that's the first thing we've announced, and obviously there's going to be a lot more coming over the next few months. Tickets are available now if you want to get them before Christmas, and they're getting there nice and early, ready for the weekend of the 10th and 11th of February, and we'll put all those in our show notes at theretrohour.com. Now, speaking of our website, that is where you can find those little buttons that will earn your place in the Retro Hour Hall of Fame. Now, the reason we do this is, you know, it's not like a Patreon. It's nothing like that. The reason we have a little tip jar on our website, that's what it is. It's just to keep the show going because I'm thinking about this. We're coming up to our second birthday. January, we're going to get hit with it all, aren't we? SoundCloud audio hosting subscription renewals, website hosting renewals, all of that is going to come up next month. So, you know, this would be really well appreciated, guys. Very well timed. If you'd like to make a little donation into the running of the show, you know, every little penny we get will make a massive difference to us. Help us keep doing the show throughout 2018 and do more events as well. So all you got to do is nip onto our website, theretrohour.com. You'll find PayPal, Bitcoin, Ethereum, however you want to donate. And just for making a donation of any amount, you'll get in the Hall of Fame. Just like this week, Kim Jorgensen.
Toby Bridson.
Elysian Pickups.
And Michael Daly.
Who all made donations into the running of the Retro Hour podcast. Thank you so much. And you can do the same just by heading onto our website, theretrohour.com. Now, if you are new to the Retro Hour podcast, because, you know, we've checked our stats recently, we've been growing at a huge rate in the last 6 months.
Oh, yeah, we've doubled, which is just absolutely fantastic. We're going to try and triple next time.
Like the ambition. Yeah. But, you know, we appreciate all our new listeners. And, of course, if you listen to the Retro Hour podcast every week, we get people saying they've listened since episode one. So that's amazing. But the way the show works is, Ravi and I sit here in our little cosy studio on a weeknight.
Cup of tea.
A nice little chalky biscuit maybe on the go as well. And we talk about the retro gaming headlines because there's lots going on this week that we're going to get through in just a moment, some interesting stories. And then in the second half of the show, we welcome on, you could almost say, you know, one of our gaming heroes.
Oh, totally. And this week we have a fantastic gaming hero. We have Alex Verry, a.k.a. Big Boy Barry. Now, Big Boy Barry is actually the longest running presenter of a video games TV show on UK television. He was on every single day on Games World. Can you believe that? Daily game show back in the 90s.
That was on Sky, wasn't it?
It was on Sky, but it was made by the same production company that did Games Master. Mm. So basically they had Dave Perry in there, they had all the other guys, but they actually found Alex as he was a contestant on Games Master.
A cocky contestant.
Contestant that won a golden joystick. So they kind of hired him. And then it got to the point that, you know, in the fourth series, he had a BTV, which was Big Boy Barry TV, with him and, the guy from Little Britain.
Oh, David Walliams.
Yeah,
I remember.
And Jet from Gladiator.
So. Oh, you remember that one.
Oh, I'll tell you, everybody remembers Jet.
So this is really interesting because, you know, that era of gaming television was just so exciting, wasn't it?
It was, and you know, Sky was kind of a brand new channel. You only had like the four channels and that was it. Mm. So you had this extra choice and they had to fill it. And, you know, this kind of fit the slot perfectly.
So Big Boy Barry is going to be our special guest this week. And it actually ties in quite well because Barry actually works with the guys from Play these days, doesn't he? So he's often at these events.
Oh, yeah. It'd be really good to do something with Barry at Play.
Oh, I'm sure we will. But he's going to be our special guest. Big Boy Barry is coming up on the Retro Hour podcast in around 20 minutes from now. Shall we get in some stories then?
Yeah, totally.
It seems that we mention the Raspberry Pi like every week at the moment.
It is, but it's because so many people are bringing out so many cool projects, and a lot of them are kind of based around the Switch. You know, this is another design that looks like the Switch, and this is called Pip.
So this is, because we did talk about a guy who'd made his own kind of Nintendo Switch retro project using a Pi last week. This one, though, is actually a commercial product that's launched on Kickstarter. Now, like you said, it does look like a Nintendo Switch, insofar as it's a handheld device. And it's got an LCD screen in there.
You can even take the sides off this one, Dan.
Yeah, that's what makes it, you know, quite like a Switch, actually, that it's got a controller on the side that actually unclips from it, just like the Switch. Battery, cameras built in as well, all the usual Raspberry Pi ports like your USB and HDMI. But this exists, really, for kids that want to learn games programming.
Totally. So there's this environment. I don't know if you've heard of it. It's called Scratch. Have you heard of that at all? It's like a Python-based language where you can kind of script and create stuff, and that originally came out on the Raspberry Pi. Now, this is available on the Pip, but the problem is, you know, you've got this tiny screen, a little D-pad and controllers. How the hell are you going to program on that?
I was thinking that when you put that in, I'm like, is it touchscreen and you've got to use like an on-screen keyboard to
plug
code?
Plug in a big keyboard and look at the tiny thing. But actually, what you do is you try out the code in your browser in a built-in emulator, so it emulates the Pip within a browser, and then one click, you can just send it over Wi-Fi to the Pip.
Yeah,
so and it will run in the native hardware.
Yeah, it deploys it straight to the machine.
Yeah, that's really smart. It's for kids, you know, you can totally experiment, mess about in your browser, break it, do whatever, and then once it's done, just send it over.
And because it is a Raspberry Pi, it can also run stuff like, you know, Raspbian on there and all the standard stuff.
Oh, Minecraft and all of your kind of games you want.
Well, it comes preloaded with Snake, which you'll be keen on. Pac-Man and Minecraft, of course, is included on it. I think this is really cool, though. I mean, the thing about it is, if you were to give maybe like a 7-8-year-old kid, which, you know, I started using computers when I was about 7-8 years old, started learning, you know, basic programming and all that kind of stuff on them then. But this looks a lot more child-friendly than giving a kid like a Raspberry Pi in the standard box.
I'd prefer to give this to my kid than a Switch, because you go, Dad, I want a new game. And you go make it.
Yeah. <That's> it. Go to your room and don't come out until you've made the next Minecraft. But at the moment, this is running on Kickstarter. And there's still around, you know, about 18 days left when this show comes out on here. And they need $39,000. It's already got $35,000. And there's still like over 2 weeks left.
It's definitely happening then.
Exactly, yeah. So I think that's really, really cool though. So if you want to find out more, and I'm not sure when this is going to be released, if there's actually a release date on it yet, but I'm sure we'll be covering it. And I wouldn't mind getting my hands on one of these, actually. It would be quite interesting to do a little video on this, I think.
Definitely.
So we'll put that in our show notes at theretrohour.com. Now, if we're talking about the early 90s, you know, maybe that period that Games World was on TV, and you remember then when the PS1 came out, and just before that we had the 3DO, and there was like a bit of a craze for real people in video games.
Oh, yes, I remember all the green screen, even with the early Amiga CD stuff, they used to have some awful stuff on that, and there was lots of PC CD-ROM titles that came out, you know, that were full horror adventures and stuff.
Well, you know, I mentioned before that I installed Windows 98 on this Pentium 4 that I've got at home. Been messing around with it. I also put, I've got a few DOS games on CD-ROM, actually. And I installed The Seventh Guest.
Oh, well, yeah. That was a big one, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was one of, maybe, must have been one of the very early.
I think it was the first. Was it Phantasmagoria or something? That was one of them.
But that was at 93, yeah, Seventh Guest came out. So it was definitely one of the early ones. And again, it was real people came in. Full motion video, obviously, it was called. And that was kind of a craze, probably only for about a year, 2 years. I know that some of the early PlayStation games have still got FMV bits in them. But really, it was more the domain of the Mega CD and the 3DO and that kind of thing. Back then, though, I mean, a lot of game studios tried to do full motion video, didn't bother spending much money on real actors, often got guys from The Office to like play characters.
Yeah, and also the resolution would be a bit sketchy back then, you know. It would look like it would be high res, but it wasn't really amazing picture quality.
You've played Night Trap.
Yeah.
But now, all these years later, the scene is set for the return of full motion video games.
Totally. Like, we've had two listeners contact us, and one has been talking about Erica, which is this brand new PlayStation 4 game, which uses Playlink system, which apparently is some kind of multiplayer mobile phone use with the PS4. So maybe you can interact with your phone whilst playing the game or play it on the move. I'm not quite sure how that works, but there's a very small kind of intro on it. As with these FMVs, you know, they've just put a little video out and that's it. But it looks really good. This is a story about a girl and it's looks like it's kind of a horror-based one.
Yeah, apparently it's the story of a young woman with a dark past that's returned to haunt her.
Yeah, there you go. And, and another one which was mentioned by Martin Bishop is actually on the PS4, which is called The Late Shift.
Right.
And this looks really, really cool. I was watching it earlier, and you're working in a garage doing a late shift, and then a girl comes and gets a really expensive car, and she suddenly gets kidnapped. Guy's got a gun to her head. And you've got to make the choices. Do I give him the keys? Do I do this? Do I run off? And it's all, you're stuck on this hellish late shift at work. And you've got to make all these decisions. So that looks fantastic. And I can't wait to hear about any other any other FMV stuff coming out.
Well, the thing is, I mean, before, like you said, the technology wasn't there for these kind of games back in the 90s. And I think because they got such a bad reputation, it's probably scared a lot of developers off doing them for a long time.
Totally, yeah.
And but it's there now, the technology. I mean, you know, you get these games here that they're filmed on like nice high definition 1080p cameras.
Oh mate, it gets really scary. I've been playing the bunker one, which I've mentioned quite a few times on this show, and you're in a nuclear bunker by yourself. That is so scary. It's unbelievable just seeing the video and the way that on these ones as well, you move your mouse to investigate stuff and the guy's head will move along with it. You know, all the elements of interactivity are really nicely done.
You know, you did mention then accidentally, but you said VR. And this twinned with virtual reality would be, that's got to be the ultimate reality experience, hasn't it?
Oh, God.
But, I mean, there is a lot of people who don't like these kind of games. I mean, I quite like, you know, the Telltale games and, like, Beyond Two Souls and Heavy Rain, those kind of games. A lot of people.
It's for a particular taste, isn't it?
Yeah, a lot of my mates are, oh, they're just movies, you know, if I want to watch a movie, I'll watch a film. But they are, you know, they're essentially interactive films, aren't they?
They are, totally. But also, I think there's a whole generation that hasn't played them. You know, that's a younger generation that's going to come onto this and be like, wow, what is this? Or, you know, much more immersive story, I feel, when I play them.
And again, it's like the technology is there and they've got like proper actors in to do them these days. So they look like, you know, Hollywood.
Yeah, it's not the staff anymore, is it?
So the time is, I mean, I'm glad to see FMV back because I think now people are going to explore the potential of it a lot more than they could back in the old days. So I welcome it back for one. I know there will be people that disagree. Kind of going the complete opposite to that, though. I've been checking out a thread on Reddit recently. Now, if you ever spend a bit of time on Reddit, you know, /r/retrogaming, really good community, a lot of interesting threads on there. Retro Battle Stations, another good one on Reddit as well. People showing out their old machines.
Showing all their rigs off.
But this one is a thread that was started by a guy whose name I won't say. I was about to read it out, but yeah, it's not family friendly, as with most of Reddit. This was started about a week ago. And the question he posed to the community on there was, why am I playing more retro games now? And he gives a few points as to why recently he's got massively back into retro games. And a few that he lists, for example. Number one, no microtransactions. Awesome local multiplayer, the couch experience. no waiting for updates, which we did mention last week when I, you know, 24 hours to get the new Call of Duty installed and updated. If a game doesn't work, you usually have to blow on your cartridge instead of downloading a patch, pick up and play versus spending whole days and weeks upgrading a character and then dying within 20 seconds because someone spent more money to upgrade theirs. I do kind of agree with that one, actually. Better storylines, replayability, and obviously nostalgia is the reasons he lists.
Yeah, I don't know. It depends on the person, because actually for me, it's quite the opposite. I'm playing a lot of brand new titles that are retro-themed, and they're providing that local two-player experience of sitting on the sofa, like Cuphead, for example, which is just fantastic and insane. And it's like, I actually find it harder to play retro games because I have to get the bloody retro setup sorted. You know, I have to blow the dust off the machine, I have to get all the cables out and get it all plugged in. Whereas my modern rig's sitting there and I can easily emulate something. I don't know. I seem to be drawn to the modern titles. How about you, Dan?
I think you're on the wrong show.
Yeah, that's it. Maybe because I talk about them too much. That's right.
But I mean, well, okay, kind of mentioning, you know, this kind of ties them both together. The system I have been playing most recently is the Switch. Mm. You know, I play my Switch way more than anything else.
But you've been playing Sonic Mania, right? Which is retro kind of themed.
Thimbleweed Park. I've been playing as well recently. But again, I think it's because it fits in my lifestyle now. But again, I mean, like this guy said about retro games, if I have got a retro system set up, the fact that you can just pick up the game and get straight in and play it, you haven't got to dick around with updates and installing and all that. But the Switch can come on the go with me. So if I'm going away for the weekend or I'm on a plane or a train, that's when I've got time to sit down and do stuff.
I guess it's easier for people that aren't nuts like us, because I know you've got 40 machines at home.
I've at least double that now.
Yeah, really? Jeez.
Must be knocking on about 70, I think.
Oh, my God. Yeah, you see. And I've got, like, about 10, and they're all in different states of repair. And, you know, that means I'm just overwhelmed with... If I want to play a game, I'm overwhelmed with all of this stuff. Compared to someone that will go, oh, get the Mega Drive out and just, you know, go on it.
We have said that before. Sometimes having too much choice, you end up playing nothing.
Yeah, that's it. It's like one of these guys that collects classic cars, and you go around his house and his garden's full of all these broken cars. I'm going to do them up one day. They're going to be great. You know, oh, I've got a beautiful one at the back, you know.
Still there for 20 years.
And they're all still wrecked. how I feel at the moment.
Well, my friend, actually, he got a Switch for his family. Wait, you know, it's for him, really. He said it for the kids the other day. And he actually sent me a picture of his son and his daughter. His son's about 8 years old, his daughter's 5. And they're there playing Mario Kart in front of the TV, sitting on the couch playing with the controllers. Oh. Couch gaming, again.
Yeah.
And it's on a cartridge, you put it back in. So the Switch has kind of brought that back.
Totally. Cool. Like, I've been sitting on the couch with my mate playing Cuphead and playing all these new two-player retro games. Yeah, it's just fantastic.
Now, but obviously there are advantages to retro games. I think, you know, obviously one thing I quite like about the old systems and playing the old games is a lot of them were, which happens less and less now, but they defined a genre. You know, you play an old game and it was the first game that was ever like that.
Yeah, there's like as we just talked about FMV, there's these lost genres like point and click and, you know, all of these ones that were massive and kind of getting the best experience is going back to those old games a lot of the time. You know?
Yeah, and seeing where it started is always interesting, isn't it? And also there are, I mean, when we were kids, we had no money to go out and buy, you know, a lot of these expensive games. I mean, people talk about the price of games today, but I remember when I was like, you know, 12 years old, like a Super Nintendo game would be about 60 quid.
I didn't have enough money to buy pirate games. They were expensive for me. 50p a disc, bloody hell.
Let alone 60 quid for a Nintendo cartridge, yeah. But again, I mean, a lot of it for me is it's having these experiences I missed out on.
Yeah.
So the games I used to read about and I didn't have the money to play them or I didn't know anyone that had them, but I've heard about them over the years, or systems that I always wanted.
That's it. You know, you were always stuck with like your crap demo discs and a few titles that you had. You never really had all the amazing ones. I remember going around my mate's house once and he had like the whole PlayStation collection. I was just like, Jesus.
Yeah. But again, I mean, if you've got something like a flash cart, you can essentially get, I mean, it's free games after that, isn't it?
Yeah, these totally.
So that is one good thing about it. I mean,
and also, I guess, now that we're getting older, there's a lot more retro stuff to play. Before, there wasn't really that much retro. You'd have your arcade stuff, and then that'd be it. And then your platformers.
Oh, and even there's loads of adventure games I want to go through that, you know, I've either played for years and forgotten about, or, you know, there's such a wealth, a massive back catalogue of games. You couldn't get through them all in your lifetime. It's like, you know.
Yeah.
So I do see the appeal that there are very valid reasons why, you know, so you often get people asking you that, like, oh, what do you want to play old games for? I've got mates that are not into retro and they don't really get it. But I think there are very valid reasons why you would. And a good game, I mean, we've all said this on the show, a good game's like a good movie. It's timeless.
Yeah, totally. Totally. It's all about the gameplay.
Right then, guys. Well, thank you for checking out episode number 98 of the Retro Hour podcast. We'll be out again next Friday, available from all of your favourite podcast clients, iTunes, Stitcher, Overcast, YouTube.
Yeah, we're everywhere. And if you could drop us a review on iTunes as well, that would be fantastic, guys.
You know, we do get some people saying, oh, why iTunes? It's the worst one. The thing is, iTunes is the biggest podcast chart, so...
It is, and it is the home of podcasting, I'm afraid.
Yeah.
Watch, actually, you guys should watch the video of Steve Jobs launching podcasting, because he then puts a podcast on, which goes ahead and starts insulting the Apple Mac and saying how bad it is, and then he desperately turns it off. So search for that on YouTube.
Was that YouTube?
Yeah, Steve Jobs launches podcasting. Yeah.
Right, I'm going to put that in the show notes before this week. That'll be worth a watch. But obviously, you know, we do have an RSS feed on our website. You can download the raw MP3s. We're on pretty much every service as well. So whatever you listen on, we really appreciate it. Thank you so much. And we'll be out again next week with episode number 99, getting close to the big 100.
Oh, yeah, special guests. Here we go.
I'm working on it. I'm working on it. But this week, speaking of special guests, this is going to be interesting. Big Boy Barry joins us next on the Retro Hour podcast. And we'll see you next week.
Ciao.
You're listening to the Retro Hour podcast, and it's time to welcome this week's very special guest. Welcome to the show, Big Boy Barry.
Hey! Well, I'm pleased to be here. How are you guys doing this evening?
Very good, thank you, Alex. Really appreciate you joining us on the show this week. Now, obviously, we're going to get some stories about your days on Games World and gaming telly back in the day. I mean, this is a question we always like to start with, because, you know, we find out a little bit about your history. What was the first ever, like, earliest gaming memory you've got then, or computers? Where did it all start for you?
Earliest gaming memory? Oh, geez, you know, it's such an ingrained part of my life, I think. Trying to think of the earliest gaming memory. I grew up with gaming, so I've got an older brother, 4 years older than me, so I guess, you know, he was always into gaming before I was, so I was sort of, my earliest gaming memory was watching him play video games, I think, and we had one of the old Ataris. We had the old Atari, VCS machines, I guess it was, the old Pong machines.
Yeah.
And I can't even remember what model it was. That's how young I was. But I do remember one of those sort of living in the house and playing Pong. But really, I think my first genuine gaming memory was the Christmas that Santa Claus brought home the 48K Speccy. So I was born in 77, and that's really the first real memory I have. I know we had an Atari. It never really worked very well, but it was the Spectrum that kind of kick-started gaming for me. And that first year where we got a Hunchback and Horace Goes Skiing and Hungry Horace and Manic Miner, and that was kind of it for me. What an amazing year that was.
Did your friends like get Spectrums around the same time then?
Everybody did, yeah. You started growing up with it, right? And then you had the format wars was so much fun, and nothing has changed. Nothing has changed, by the way, through to 2017, nothing has changed. And you always, you know, we had the Speccy, and then the rich kids always had the C64, right? And then the oddballs whose parents were absolutely insistent that the computers were there for education bought the BBC. And then there were a few strange kids who had the Amstrad as well, who didn't really sort of fit in either camp. But it was usually Speccy versus Commodore 64. But yeah, everybody started growing up and playing games at the same time. And you'd go around each other's houses and you'd swap games and you'd swap dodgy games that you recorded on cassette that would never work properly, and then you'd start the arguments over what's better, be it C64 or Speccy. I always fell in the Speccy camp, but like most people who play in the Spectrum, love my Speccy, secretly wanted a C64 at the same time, I think.
Well, later on, did you get any consoles as well?
I did, you know, I did, and really, it was the... you know, it was the NES that kind of did it. When the NES started to appear in the 80s, you know, Mario was just a thing of beauty. I always wanted a console. Since consoles started appearing in the high street in Dixon's window, you know, I always wanted to start a console. My parents wouldn't let me have them, though, because they were under the misguided belief that I think all parents of the 80s were, that, you know, they bought a computer for educational purposes and you happen to play games on it as well, which is, of course, just, you know, a load of nonsense. nobody was really using the computers for educational purposes. Actually, you'd type in a few bits of code from now and again that you'd find in your Sinclair. But really, We just bought computers so you could play games on them. But our parents thought they were there for education. So they wanted a computer because they thought it would help you with your studies or some other nonsense. We were only ever playing games on them. But then they saw that, you know, the cartridges were like, you know, 40, 50 quid. So I think my parents always had an issue there. And when you're growing up and you're young, yeah, your parents are the gatekeepers, right? Because they're the ones buying the kit for you. And they resisted for a very long time. So I always wanted a NES, and I'd go around to my buddies' houses that would have Master System as well, or NES, and I'd live around there playing Punch-Out or Super Mario Brothers or Alex Kidd on the Master System. Used to love that. And then it wasn't really until the Mega Drive came along. I guess I was sort of 13, 14, just started getting a little bit of money for myself. That was the first console that I think I purchased. Even though, you know, been playing NES and Master System for years beforehand, the first console I purchased was the Mega Drive, and that was done with my own money. And you start to get kind of a tiny bit of financial freedom at that age where you can just about get it past the parents, I think.
I remember a friend of mine at school actually got an early Mega Drive, and I think it was before they came out here, like one of the Japanese imports. And
right.
When we saw that, it was like something out of the future. It was like, like an arcade machine in your house.
Oh, it's just a different world, right? I mean, it's just and that was the big deal, right? That everyone was importing the machines at that time, and they would have, you know, switches or mods or whatever, or come with the power supplies to get the machines to run off 220 volts or whatever. They used to be seriously dangerous. These things, and I remember buddies importing them in. It was always the rich kid. They'd always have like one rich kid that would bring them in, and the games would be like 70, 80 pounds a throw, right? Even back then, and that was serious money. But yeah, it was just nuts when you started seeing like DJ Kid and you know, some of the early games on Mega Drive, which Altered Beast, of course. You know, you just couldn't believe it. As you say, it was the first real machine to truly bring that arcade experience to the home, and it was incredible. You just never looked back from there. You knew you had to have it, you just didn't figure out how you were going to afford it.
Well, you and your friend were kind of browsing through teletext, and you found something interesting. Could you expand on that?
You've done your research. Well done. look how professional you guys are. I'm impressed.
We've done this a couple of times.
You've done this. It's not your first rodeo, is it? Look at that. Look at that. These guys are the pros. I love it. oh, my gosh. So what year is that? It's got to be early 90s. Teletext. Teletext was a thing, right? Digitizer.
Mm.
Remember Digitizer?
Mr. Biffo.
God, the kids today will never have the delights of loading up. It's the only thing to do at my grandma's house, right? And again, around that age, when you're sort of 13, 14, you've got to go around to grandma's house, and you just got absolute sweet FA to do around there. And I just relied on Digitizer. It was the closest thing that we had to sort of surfing your phones and looking at Facebook, which I guess is today's equivalent. But Mr. Biffo was superb. Digitizer got away with a lot of stuff, right? It was seriously weird.
The worm being sick at the very end.
You know what I mean? Right? It's just, it was quite subverted, and loved it. Loved Digitizer. And yeah, so this must be going back early 90s, and there was a message on Digitizer that there was a new TV show coming on that was going to be about video games, which, you know, I mean, this is revolutionary back in the day, right? That's never been done before. A TV show about video games, that's fantastic. And they were giving away audience tickets, and they gave you a phone number to phone and try and get audience tickets. So my buddy and I, my buddy Martin Mathers and myself phoned up the hotline number to get audience tickets for this new TV show that's being made for Channel 4. Called Games Master, and we got some audience tickets. And then we found out that, you know, it was being shot in the middle of nowhere in an old abandoned church in the middle of the city, and it was right when the schools went back in September, so it was being done right in term time. But we didn't care anyway. We figured we'd figure out a way to sort of bunk off school and go along and watch this video game show being filmed. And there you go. And I remember, I think you had to leave a message to get audience tickets. And then we got a phone call back from one of the researchers to say, can we bring some more people? Because he got nobody. The show had never been shown before on TV, so no one had any idea what the hell Games Master was all about. And they couldn't fill the audience seats because, again, it was in term time. So they asked us, I don't think you could do this now. They asked us if we could get some more people to bunk off school and come watch the show.
Wow.
Could get away with it. They did. They said, like, if you want any buddies, because we give you as many seats as you want. And we said, well, you know, we'll ask around. And I think we did. I think we roped a few more people to come in and watch it. But then, you know, they had their begging tray out. They were looking for contestants for challenges on games. And again, this show had never been done before. So, you know, they had a real issue convincing people that this was going to be, you know, a worthwhile endeavor to come down for the day. So they were desperate for contestants to come on and try and win prizes, which would turn out to be the golden joystick. And they were desperate for people to come down. So they said, you know, do you know anybody that would like to be on TV and that are good at video games? And I think both myself and my buddy Martin said, yes, us, we'll do that. And then we trekked down to the Docklands, which again in those days was sort of abandoned and was tough to get to, which is where the offices of the production studio was. It was a production studio called Hewland International. Mm-hmm. And we trekked down and we met those guys very briefly, and they said, yeah, have all the audience tickets you want, and you guys were a lot of fun, so we're going to pencil you in to come on the show and compete. And that was that. I went on Series 1 playing Sonic the Hedgehog. I think it was either Episode 1 or Episode 2 of Games Master ever made. I was on playing Sonic the Hedgehog. And that was me at, I think, 13 or 14 years old, making my TV debut.
Kind of locked in those cages with the little dwarves and everything.
It was. It really was. And again, it was just, it was, I don't know, it was very bizarre when you think back at it. And, like, you know, you think, I was kind of young, but I went down there on the bus together with me and Martin and a few people to watch, and I just don't know if we'd get away with that today. I don't know if today's parents would allow. It was quite dodgy because it was in term time as well. I can't remember what damn excuse we used to bunk off school, but it was, you know, it was a pretty intense day, and it was the most inhospitable filming conditions, I think, because again, it wasn't a set; it was a real church. And you know, there were lights everywhere and it was hot, and they, you know, they were right at the start of production and they didn't know how to shoot this damn show, and everything took so long. And then hilariously, they had hardly anybody there in the audience. I mean, they were still having a real issue filming it. So they had to, the few people that they had, they had to shunt over to sort of one side of the studio seating and then film it from a certain direction to make it look like that the place was full. And then they'd stop the cameras and move the few people they had in the audience.
I just saw that guy's twin at the other side of the room.
Exactly. If you watch closely, you'll just see the same folks just dotted around in different positions.
That's hilarious.
Like, it's funny. It's funny. Now, of course, you know, the show aired. Rest is history. Huge, huge hit on Channel 4. And then I think by Series 2, you know, they had no problem getting, you know, really good contestants in and really good, you know, huge amounts of audience. People were clamoring for tickets. They just had no problem at all. But that first year, we got in at the right time. There's no doubt about it.
And have you still got your golden joystick?
As I speak to you, there's no word of a lie. As I speak to you, I am gazing at my golden joystick. Now, I understand that sounds a little perverse, but I do actually read the genuine Games Master Golden Joystick. I do. I have my Games Master Golden Joystick.
We're very jealous here.
I love the fact that, I mean, that was the most coveted prize in gaming, even though it was like, what, a Cheetah 125 spray painted gold, wasn't it?
I think so, yeah. I'm looking at it now. I think it's a quick shot. I think it's a Kempston quick shot, just spray painted gold. Really badly, by the way. I mean, it's, you know, it is pretty bad, and the Perspex box that it's kind of mounted in is all sort of yellowing up and is looking a bit ghetto, but still got it, still in one piece. And you know, it's interesting, isn't it? It is interesting, because I think I went on it and, like, you know, my parents taped it on the VCR and phone up all the relatives and all your mates and everything, and everyone at school is watching, and you have that sort of 24 hours where it's really cool and it goes out on air. But yeah, I remember my dad, bless him, you know, making a quip like, oh, they could have given you a games console or something as a prize. Is that all you got, that gold joystick? Which, you know, he meant very nicely as a joke, but I felt a bit dejected when he said that.
Like, this is amazing. It's the golden joystick.
It's real gold, surely. It's got to be worth a fortune. But But it's funny, isn't it? Because it's really what it signified more than anything else, and certainly set me off onto a career path. You've got to hand it to Jane Hewland. Jane Hewland, by the way, remarkable lady. You should try to get her on the Retro Podcast because she's an incredible person. So she's a visionary, you know, and she got the idea for Games Master because she had her young kid called Harry, who was even younger at that time, and is a lovely chap, actually, was just playing video games all the time, and she just couldn't figure out why there was nothing on air. You know, now, of course, it's a whole different situation where we have the internet, YouTube and Twitch and hundreds of ways to watch people play games, inform ourselves of games, see trailers for games. Back then, there really wasn't anything, right? You had magazines that would show screenshots of games coming up, you know, months later than you know, they were actually issued to the magazines. So news cycles were always very late. Because of the nature of print advertising, there was no real way to see games move. So Games Master was revolutionary. It was the first thing to do what it did. And there was nothing but Games Master for the first year. So it had a good, clear year, possibly even 2 years. You'll have to see that. But there was nothing at the time to rival Games Master. It took a year or so for everybody else to catch up to the idea that this might be something. You know, this is getting the kids interested. You know, and TV execs didn't really understand it back in that day. They don't really understand it now.
Well, Hewland International later on approached you because they were creating a new show, and you'd obviously got on well with them, and your cockiness seemed to help that situation as well.
Yeah, extreme cockiness. Extreme cockiness. It did. It helped my situation. So when I was on Games Master, oh God, I didn't try to be that cocky. I'm just cocky, but I was just a cocky little kid by nature, right? But you know, so the initial challenge they set for me for Sonic was to collect like 130 rings or 120 rings. I don't know what it is. And you know, I think like most of us, when we were younger, we were just much better gamers because your reflexes are faster, and you have no life, right? Your life is school. And then, you know, stuff to do in between school and bed. You could pretty much get away with playing games for hours and hours and hours every day. I wish I could do that now, but I can't. So I would, you know, I would just be practicing that same level on Sonic day in, day. And I got to a point where it's kind of muscle memory, and I found every ring on that course, and there was something like 142 rings, I think, and I managed to get every single one of them. And, you know, unless something catastrophic happened, I would do it fairly easily without dying. So a couple of weeks before the show aired, when I was well into practice, you know, the researchers called me and said, you know, how are you doing? Are you getting those 120 rings? Are you going to be good for the filming day? And I was like, I can get 142. I can do all 142. And that was really it. And I was actually shocked when I turned up for filming on that day, and Dominic interviews me, and they said, okay, so, yeah, we heard that you asked for it to be changed to 142 rings. and that was honestly true. As they were interviewing, you can watch it on YouTube, guys. Go back and watch it on YouTube. It was at that point, I had not been told I was doing 142 rings, but I got 142 rings. And I got the golden joystick. In fact, I didn't. There's a little bit of video game history for you. My entire career was almost destroyed in under 3 seconds of my appearance on Games Master. So I'll let you in a little secret. I could probably get in trouble for telling you this. But when we shot it, in order to get those 142 rings in the allotted time, I think I had to start. You had to start with like a Sonic jump. You had to do like your little spinball thing and then jump. And I fluffed it. I died. I died literally within 3 seconds. I died within 3 seconds. And that was it. That was game over. And, you know, I got up and was ready to film me walking back to the pulpit. But it was just tremendously bad television. So they gave it a few seconds, and then you just heard the voice from the gallery, as they call, which is where all the director sits and stuff, and says, you know, I think we can probably try that one again and see if he can do a little bit better. And they gave me a second try. They gave me a do-over. It's lucky that I died in the first few seconds. I think if I had died like a minute and a half in, then that would have been that, and I would have gone home, and they may never have called me back. But because I died in the first couple of seconds, they gave me another shot, did it, won the golden joystick, and then they called me back the following year. So Sky TV, which was an emerging force, and everyone that bought Sky at that point, you'd buy Sky for what? For wrestling or for Simpsons? Mm. It was not much. Yeah. There was not much else, and that's all in itself all right. And you bought Sky for Simpsons and wrestling, and they kind of, it was the very early days of Sky where they were working out what they wanted to do and what they wanted to be, and they were dipping their toe into original programming, trying to sort of shake off the stigma of it just being sort of US reruns and stuff, and they wanted to do some original programming, but they just had no money. They had absolutely very, very low budgets, but they saw what was going on with Gamesmaster, and they wanted some of that for themselves. So Sky contacted Hewland International to see if they'd be interested in trying to repeat the formula and doing a spin-off for them on Sky, and ideally give them something they could strip across 5 nights a week. So they wanted something Monday to Friday at sort of tea time slot, 6:30 in the evening, and had to be cheap to film, had to be cheap to make, and Hewland rose to the channel, so they to the challenge. So they did a spin-off, and the show was called Game Zone, and they went into production on Game Zone, and I remember seeing logos for Game Zone and early concepts of how that show would look. And then there was a magazine at the time. Again, magazines were big, and there was a magazine called Game Zone. So right at the last minute, I think they were scared of legal action, so they changed the name to Games World. So they called me after remembering my performance on Channel 4, and they called me back, and they brought me in to see would I be interested in repeating that role. They were looking for good gamers who could hold their own in front of a camera, which was easier said than done, certainly back then. Mm. So I was a pro gamer before there was a pro gamer, right? I think they were the early pro gamers, and they wanted people that could play games and be house champions. And it was the idea was that it was going to be a take on gladiators, right? So they were going to call them videators. They needed house champions, and their main thread of the show was going to be something called The Eliminator and then Beat the Elite. And that's, you know, kids playing other kids against themselves on a Monday and a Wednesday. And then they'd organize a tournament, and the winner of the Monday show goes on to face the winner of the Wednesday show. And the winner of the Wednesday show goes on to face the house champions, the videators.
How did the concept of Big Boy Barry come around then?
So that's interesting. So they had obviously a team of people, working on the show and different concepts. And they actually had some very big names. They had a guy who's now a very famous producer who's gone on to produce Big Brother, a guy called Philip Edgar Jones, who's very, very well known in TV circles. And he was working on the show at the time. They had a guy called Steve Merritt, who also went on to do stuff on Games Master. So they had some talented people. I don't think any of the videators, I wouldn't want to give any one person credit for coming up with the characters. But they did also have one researcher who was pretty good at comedy, and whose job was to sort of work on different characters and work on different personas for these people to fill. And that guy was a guy called David Walliams. And there we go. So he was a pretty good comedian, and he was working as a researcher. So I met David during season one, where he was working as a researcher, and we kind of worked on this character together, on what this character was going to be and how he was going to act and give some sort of very basic gimmicks and stuff. And it was all pretty sort of two-dimensional for that first series, which it had to be, really, because you've just got to come on and make an instant impact, and you've only got a couple of minutes screen time before you play games and then sort of go off again. And that first series was all very basic, very broad characters. So you had, a ninja, you had a gaming grandma, you had the executioner, you had a guy dressed as Jesus called the Gaming Messiah, and then you had Big Boy Barry. So originally it was going to be a more kind of Harry Enfield, loads of money character. He was going to be much more obnoxious and much more of a bully. But we kind of just sort of loosened it a little bit, and we made him more of a fan favorite almost by accident. And there we go. But, David and I worked on some simple catchphrases, the big is best, and all that kind of good stuff. And that's how Big Boy Barry was born.
Well, you also had the gaming goddess as well, which was a...
You did, yeah, yep. So Man of Pixels, Pete Barlow, had Jet, Diane Udell from the Gladiators, playing the game's mistress. Yeah, so she was in Series 2 as well. So you'd have this bad computer generated character, Madame Pixels. She'd serve to sort of do the links, and then, you know, she'd cut to David doing his comedy characters, giving out tips and cheats. Then you'd have the game's mistress dressed in sort of very risque leather costumes, giving out tips and cheats.
In a kind of boudoir as well.
In a boudoir, I know. It's like, how did we get away with it?
Compare that to Patrick Moore.
I know. Well, go figure. Yeah, I always like to think that Games Master was for the mainstream. That's where all the money was. You know, they had the best guests. They had the footballers and Vic Reeves and Liam Gallagher or whatever. They had all the best guests and they had all the money and they had all the ratings. But Games World was where the cool kids would kind of hang out. That's where the real geeks were. The real gamers would always prefer Games World.
I always thought that Bob Mills was an interesting choice for the host of the show. I mean,
yeah.
It was a bit of a bizarre fit, you know, to look at it on paper, but it did work, didn't it? What, was he much of a gamer, and how did you kind of get on with him?
Shouldn't have worked, I don't think. It shouldn't have worked. It was. Do you know, the Bob Mills thing is a very interesting point. I've never actually gotten to the bottom of whose decision it was to bring him in and why. Because you're right, on paper, it really shouldn't have worked. And I think it's one of those nice cases of sort of casting against type. No, not a gamer at all. He knew absolutely nothing about games. Don't think he liked them. Don't think he cared for them. And I think that kind of showed on screen. And he was sort of that anti-host. And that sort of, you know, that anti-games loving host. And it just worked because he had the right brand of sarcasm that wasn't too mean, wasn't too nasty to the kids. That just kind of worked. And in fact, sometimes he would go overboard. Sometimes you'd have kids just burst out into tears when Bob or one of us would lay into them, but they were playing really badly and they were losing all their games. Sometimes they would just burst into tears and you'd have to cut and go and cheer them up, and Bob would really apologize to them and cheer them up and then start again. So sometimes it got tiny bit out of hand, but not generally. He was really the nicest of nice guys. Lovely guy, Bob. Never had a problem with him. Always worked well. He kind of kept himself to himself. The voice for the gamers would always be in the form of the commentator or the co-host. So they switched between Tim Boone, who was an editor of I think CMVG magazine back in the time, and then they'd have Jeremy Daudry, and then they'd have Dave the Games Animal Perry do commentary, and it was always the sort of commentator role who would know about the games and be that voice of the gamer, and Bob would, you know, just play the innocent, and quite rightly so, and there you go. But I got on very well with him. I think, you know, he appreciated working with me, because I think it could be quite hard for him, because, you know, he's the host, and he usually sort of nailed every take first time. And then certainly the first series, most of the videators were an absolute disaster, because they casted them wrong. They just didn't know what they were looking for. So, you know, they went with a lot of actors, people that were very good on camera, that they hoped they could train up to play games well, and they couldn't. It was pretty disastrous. So, you know, you had a mix between those guys, and then they'd have some very good gamers who were just terrible in front of a camera. So Bob would always like working with the videators who could deliver a couple of lines without fluffing it and having to do take after take after take. So him and I used to get on pretty well, because we'd never usually need to do more than one or two takes.
Well, Dave Perry, as you mentioned, he was from Games Master, and he was also a big editor of magazines and stuff back then. I remember he was very involved in the magazine world.
I spoke to him today, you know. Isn't that bizarre? I was speaking to him on Facebook today, yeah.
He's kind of made a bit of a comeback recently, hasn't he, Dave?
He has. He's dipping his toe back into gaming. I hope he doesn't mind me saying that. But,
no, we did one of the first interviews with him for a long time. We found him in a tattoo shop.
Yeah, right, 2 years ago.
He's got a tattoo parlor now, right, in Brighton or something, or Bournemouth. Nice guy. I've always gone on well with Dave. I've never had an issue with Dave. He's always been a nice guy and respected his work. Yeah.
Well, he was an editor of Games World magazine as well. And
yes.
I understand that was with Paragon, which was a different...
Paragon Publishing, yeah. Now, we went down. I do remember, actually, it's very funny. We spent a whole day. So by year two, which is, I think, when the Games Master magazine launched, that's when the brand was really growing. And so year two is when they gave me my own show. So Madam Pixel, they axed Madam Pixel's Pete Parler, and they gave Tuesday Night to me to do a sort of sitcom format. So it was Barry's Joypad. And that was me as Big Boy Barry. That was David Walliams playing my sidekick Leslie and multiple other characters. And that's really when things started to take off. That was so much fun. But every week we would do a feature, you know, and they spent money on it. So they, you know, I'd fly out to America to do E3 or CES or whatever it was at the time. Or I'd, you know, we'd go down and look at, you know, big new games being made, or, you know, the 3DO being launched, or whatever it might be. And I remember we did a feature at Paragon Publishing at Games World, the magazine, seeing what it's like to put a magazine together.
Oh.
And we spent all day down there, and it was really good. We interviewed lots of guys, and the feature turned out fantastically well. About an hour before the show aired. This would happen a lot, by the way. You talk about getting stuff passed on Sky. They did have a sensor, and sometimes that sensor would only get to see the show like 30 minutes or an hour before it was due to air. This is the truth. I have no idea how that happened, but, you know, the show was on such a tight schedule that sometimes they only got to see it like an hour or so before it went to air. And very often, some of the stuff that we were doing, or 9 times out of 10 that David Walliams was doing and trying to get away with, you know, the censor would just say, no, absolutely not. You can't go out like that. And we're like, well, the show's airing in an hour. You know, what do you want to do? So they would have to, they would have to make cuts up to the very last second to get stuff past the censor.
Wow.
And that was one such case. The whole feature that we did at Paragon Publishing had to be cut. Sky would not let it go because that it wasn't impartial enough, and they felt the feature was too much of an advert for the own brand of the magazine, which in hindsight it probably was. But it's curious, and so they had to at the last minute they cut out the entire feature, and I think that I can't remember what they did. I think they either reused a feature from last week's, which was just bizarre. Or cut it out entirely, but it never aired.
Well, speaking of it, in the moments on Games World that we may have not seen in its entirety on TV, I heard about a rather awkward trip to Sega World that you had, where you were rather
come
ill,
on.
Apparently.
Come on! All right,
what was the story there, then?
Well, how do you know the story? I want to know where you got the story from.
I may have heard it somewhere. I couldn't possibly reveal myself.
That's amazing. You have done your homework. Oh, there'd be all kinds of adventures making the features at Games Games World. It was fun. You know, it was 26 episodes a year, so we'd have to find 26 vaguely interesting features to go down and shoot. So the day you're talking about was not a fun day. So we went down to, I think we were scraping the barrel a little bit, actually, for ideas, but we went down to Sega World. Again, back in the 90s, arcades were still a thing, right?
The Trocadero.
The Trocadero. You remember that?
Yeah.
That was still a thing, right? We did features down at the Trocadero, no doubt, when new arcades would come in, right? So I think we were the first people in the world to show Super Street Fighter 4 when they had new characters come on there, and we went down to the first arcade in the UK, which I think was the Trocadero, that had the machine, and we did a feature there, you know? That was massive then, because nobody had damn well seen the game moving, because no YouTube, no internet. So these were the sorts of things we would do, and that would bring us big, big ratings. So we went down to Sega World, which was in Bournemouth, that had just got a revolutionary new arcade machine called the G-Lock 360. Now, you guys have got to go and do a Google of the G-Lock 360, because it's one of these...
Was it that gyroscope thing?
Spins around.
I think I remember seeing it. God.
Yeah, it's the big gyroscope thing. So you'd sit in it, and the game was basically Afterburner, right? It was called G-Lock, but it wasn't. It was really... It was Afterburner. It was a progression of Afterburner. Same sort of game. You know, you'd be playing a plane and you got to start shooting things. But the big novelty is that you're in this gyroscope. So, you know, it was more of a fairground attraction than anything else. And it would spin you upside down and left and right. And you'd move the joystick. And wherever you'd go, you'd just start, you know, it would just start going completely nuts. And great fun. But the day we went down there, I had flu. And it wasn't man flu. It was flu. I was feeling bad. And it was like a 2-hour journey from where I was living at the time down to Bournemouth. And I remember I was falling asleep in the cab and I just felt terrible. But, you know, I was a pro. The show had to go on. I didn't want to let anybody down and I wanted to keep the show on the road. But throughout the day I was shivering. And, makeup was working hard because I was white and I was sweating and I was just feeling terrible. And we were shooting this whole feature down at Sega World, and they had all these different arcades. And then the last feature, the last part that we were going to film of the day was the G-Lock. And they were like, you know, Barry, you've got to get in it and you've got to try it out because that's what the whole feature's leading up to. And I'm like, guys, I'm going to just hurl. I just feel, I feel so, please don't make me, please don't make me. And they were like, you've got to do it, you've got to do it. But look, we'll get you in, we'll set up the camera and the lights before you get in, and then we'll get in, we'll shoot you for like a minute and a half. We'll just do some very light movements. You don't have to go upside down in the damn thing, and then we'll get you out. You can go home. And I'm like, do you promise? Yeah, I promise, no problem. So, the costume that I was wearing is, you know, so I'm on there with all the fake gold rings and the fake Rolex, and they had me in like a fur jacket, like a big pimp jacket, and it was just, it was crazy. So we sat in this thing. And I said, you know, please, guys, just go gentle and let's only have like a minute of shooting. And the machine started. And the first thing it does is it orientates itself upside down. So it just goes upside down. I had no idea it was going to go upside down. So it flings me upside down. At that point, my fur jacket that I'm wearing tips over and interrupts the sensor that the machine has got. So the machine has got these sensors that if anything leaves the cabin, it automatically switches down because it doesn't want to chop your hand off or whatever. And it just shuts down and sirens start. And then it asks the technician. So the code breaks the sensor, goes outside. I'm hanging upside down. The sirens go off. And I'm just about to be sick. And the machine was only just installed. So all of the staff had no idea how to reset the machine and orientate the machine. So if you remember the scene at the beginning of like RoboCop, remember when Ed 209 goes wrong and starts shooting everybody and they got all the scientists just trying to work on the damn thing to try to shut it down? Well, that was me, and I was hanging upside down for like 18 minutes while they were trying to reset this damn thing, and I just turned white, and I'm like, yeah, I could just feel the vomit rising up in my throat, and I managed to keep it together. The bastard production crew, they were just in hysterics. They were filming the whole thing for the Christmas reel, this is for the Christmas party, and that was a terrible, terrible day for me.
Have you been on a G-Lock 360 since?
Never. That literally brings me out in a cold sweat just thinking about it. It's just like, nope, done with that, one and done, I'm done with that.
Well, I was just thinking the other day about what, you know, an amazing decade the 90s was for gaming, really. I mean, you know, we started in 1990, the Mega Drive had just come out. By the end of the decade, the PS2 was about to come out. You know, that was a massive change. In the years that Games World were on air, you covered such, you know, that really important, pivotal change in gaming. What were some, like, the most impressive memories you've got then, or most amazing things you saw?
Well, you know, and just trying to figure out where it was going, you know, and you're absolutely right. The first sort of, the first year of working on that show was kind of, you know, Mega Drive was still the king. Mega Drive and Super Nintendo were the king. And then, you know, I loved being in that environment. I'd love going in to film the show every day, certainly when you're doing the tournament stuff, because they had a Neo Geo, right? So you're playing on a Neo Geo, and that would feature in a lot of the matches. Now, no normal kid had a Neo Geo, because the games were like 200 quid a piece, but, you know, that was absolutely amazing. And, you know, they'd give away an arcade machine at the end of every season to the grand winner. So that was incredible as well. So, you know, it was an amazing time. And then it was strange, actually, and I think this is perhaps part of the reason why the show did end, well, when it ended, because you immediately went into what I call the wilderness years, where the industry didn't quite know how it was going to turn out, how it was going to orientate itself. So you're talking about the era of the CDI and the 3DO, you know, all precursors to the PlayStation. So you had that sort of weird 1 or 2 years where actually, towards the end of filming, the Mega Drive and the SNES were getting a little stale, and they were beginning to run out of steam. And then you had, like, you know, full motion video movies, you know, Night Trap, Sewer Shark, Ground Zero Texas. I remember doing features on all of those. We'd go out to the States and meet the guys putting that together. And you know, there was a while where everyone thought that was going to be the future. And I think from a gamer perspective, not really. But you had all these emerging technologies, VR as well. So we'd go down to the Trocadero and we'd shoot the VR experiences, which they are laughably crude. But back then, I mean, they made you feel as sick as hell because the frame rate was so terrible. But back then, it was all kind of revolutionary. So you had all this new technology starting to come up that was fascinating to watch. And then the Saturn launching, and you know, I remember we were the first TV show I think to cover the PlayStation 1 when that launched, and Ridge Racer and Toshinden and some of those games. That was right at the end of our run as we were going into 95. We were covering the Japanese import of those machines. And it's kind of a shame because you feel that if the show had ran another couple of years, I think the popularity would have gone many, many times to even where it was at the height of its run, as the gaming industry started to find its feet again.
Well, you decided to stay in the gaming industry and kind of created your own PR company and managed to get global and communications director for Mad Catz.
You're very sweet. Thank you very much. Yes, no, I did. I stayed in industry. So when Games World ended, I did TV. I did a fair bit more of TV, actually. So Games World ended, I think, in 94. I did a live video game show for children's ITV that was produced by Scottish TV called Tiggs.
Oh, with the wonderful Gail Porter.
Gail Porter. Well done. So that was the totally interactive game show, Tiggs. So that ran a year. That was good fun. And then I kind of went back to Sky. And Hewland actually launched something called the Computer Channel. So they got a new contract from Sky to do a two-hour segment every day. So it wasn't really a channel. It was 2 hours a day. But it qualified as a channel. They called it the Computer Channel. And it never really knew what it wanted to be, I don't think. It was trying to be family-orientated and educational and... you know, but they did have a gaming strand as well. So I presented the gaming strand. I did that with Donna Air and with various different co-hosts for a couple of years. And that ran Monday to Friday, again on Sky. Then they brought Games World back very briefly in like an Aztec setting. And they made it a morning show. And that was around the year 2000. Andy Collins, who's on BBC Three Counties Radio now, he's a really good guy, one of the best warm-up men in the business, in fact. He was presented that year. He took over from Bob Mills, and I took over the commentary position for that year. So Games World did come back briefly. That was good fun. And then, you know, I think as the TV stuff started to become more and more unreliable, I made a personal decision in my career. Like, what was I going to focus on? Was I going to focus on more of the TV side of things, knowing that the opportunities for gaming TV was starting to become farther and fewer between, as it were, or do I go and concentrate on the actual games? And I still love the games, so I decided to segue into gaming PR, and that's where I am today.
Well, speaking of you personally, I mean, we haven't seen the last of Big Boy Barry, because I know at Play Expo in the last couple of years, we've seen you there. So, I mean, are there any plans to do more as Big Boy Barry then, or maybe even like a BTV Kickstarter?
I would love it. Over the years, there's been, you know, I've talked to so many different people about different pilots. For video game shows, with the mainstream terrestrial TV guys, with smaller guys, and you know, one producer in particular who's actually a very big producer working today, just a big fan of Games World back then, and had a whole pilot and had a whole idea of a segment for Big Boy Barry, where he was going to have Big Boy Barry working down on his lap, working in a kebab shop, cutting out kebabs and giving out tips and cheats to different customers every week. And that was kind of fun as well. So there have been so many different ideas over the years. I'm the first one there. I'm there. Sign me up. Anyone wants to talk to me about bringing Big Boy back? Of course, absolutely. I still keep my... still keep my finger in the TV side of things. PR is my day job in the gaming industry, and Little Big PR, which is my my agency that I run with my supremely talented business partner, Mr. Gareth Williams. That keeps us incredibly busy. That's doing well, we're pleased to say, and takes up all of my time, really. But presenting and the big boy, got me in the industry, and I'll never forget that, and I'll never turn my back on it. And I kind of think that Big Boy Barry and Alex Berry are sort of the same person, and I don't shy away from it. I have a personalised number plate, which is BBB. I have BBB monogrammed on all my luggage. I don't shy away, but I embrace it. I love it, and I never forget that Big Boy Barry and got me into the industry, and it's an industry that I love. So, yeah, at Play Expo, I've still got the costume, and it still fits, which is just insane. And I dressed up and did a panel. And I'm still speaking to people today about bringing the big boy back. So I'd love to. I keep talking about doing a YouTube video. I think that's probably the natural fit for it these days. Is bringing big boy back via YouTube. I'm just too busy and lazy to figure out how to get that sort of kick started. Every year I say this is going to be the year I'll do it, but maybe I'll get round to it in 2018.
Well, obviously, we've got Play Expo coming up in February, so hopefully we'll see you there, Alex.
We will be down there. The big boy will be down there. The Round Sound Lovable Mound, the Gainly Gaming Guru, the Tubby Time, the Tea Time Telly, the Broad Buccaneer of Broadcasting, the Portly Prince of Prime Time, the Madman Mountains, the Red Hot Tip Top Non-Stop One-Stop Shop Roller Coaster Ride of Fun will be there in February. And looking forward to seeing you guys there.
Oh, he's still got it.
Still got it. Never going to lose it.
Alex,
you better believe it.
Barry, we appreciate you joining us this week. It's been really interesting talking to you. Thank you so much for coming.
I've had
up.
So much
Thanks
fun.
So
Hope
much.
You found it a little bit interesting, guys. And, I look forward to doing it again soon.